Gut, seid ihr alle da?
Yes, hallo.
Hallo, ja, die meisten sind da. Very good. Are there any questions regarding the last session? Anything that came up that you would like to discuss? Please raise your hand. No, nothing. Good. Then let's continue with the next part, which is on mixed models. Okay, can you briefly raise your hand if you can see something? Okay, that looks very good. So this part is then maybe from my perspective at least the most conventional part of this session on statistics for meta-analysis. It's concerned with fixed random and mixed effects models, and these are of course the same fixed random and mixed effects models that you may have encountered in your statistics lifetime before. So maybe as a first question, who of you has learned statistics in the context of the general linear model, or who is familiar with the general linear model? Okay, that's surprisingly many, which is good because often statistics in undergrad statistics is not taught in the GLM scenario, which makes things much more complicated than they should be. So if you're roughly familiar with the GLM theory, the distribution theory, and things that you can do in GLMs, then of course making the step to random effects models is not that hard, and also mixed effects models then is easily clarified. There are some particularities in meta-analysis, and this is basically what I was most interested in. First thing, when we now talk about modeling observed effect sizes in studies using essentially mixed effects models, so general linear models with random and fixed effects, it's a little bit different and slightly in conflict with what we've just discussed, where we basically discussed that the effect size estimates are t distributed. Now we assume all the time that the effect size estimates are normally distributed. This is also due to the fact that, as we will see, we assume that the variances of a given study are known, which is, of course, a little bit of a strong assumption, I would say. But this is how these classical fixed and random effects models in meta-analysis play out. So there's a slight conflict. So this is what I want to say. There's a slight conflict between the modeling that's happening in this section compared to the modeling that happened in the previous section, which is also addressed in the literature. So if you read the Hedges article on random and fixed effects, this is basically the kind of first sentence. If you have relatively large samples in your individual studies, then of course the non-central t distribution and the non-central or the normal distribution at a given location are not very different. So this normal distribution assumption is appropriate. If you assume this appropriateness of the normal distribution, then what fixed random and mixed effects models is all is about is modeling observed standardized effect sizes using the general linear model. And of course, this is then the same idea as you might have encountered previously in fixed random and mixed effects. So in fixed effects meta-analysis models, you assume that the observed effect sizes vary around a true fixed but unknown effect size. So there's a single effect size, and the observed effect size in each study vary around this. We will look closely in a second at that. In random effects meta-analysis models, you assume that the effect size varies a little bit between, or to some degree between, studies, and then there's additional within study variation. And then with mixed effects models, you can assume that there are both with study-specific effects that don't have a between-study variation, and study-specific effects that have a between-study variation, as we will look at. And essentially, all of these things come down, from my perspective, to the estimation theory of general linear models, specifically in terms of variance component estimation, where you have different sources at different levels of variance, and based on your observation, you need to make some sense of that, which is not necessarily that easy, and often you need constraints to get to robust estimation techniques, let's say. So I will go over the classical versions of the fixed effect model and the random effects model. In the meta-analysis literature, you find them being discussed as such. So there are a number of review articles that discuss the fixed versus random effects meta-analysis model, and that there's some confusion and blah blah blah. So I will first tell you about those, how they actually look in the meta-analysis literature, and then in the last part of this I will then try to make the link to standard GLM theory, where I guess most of these things can actually be addressed. So after that intro, now the fixed effect meta-analysis model. In this case, we don't assume that we're a single study first, and we also don't make this a specific distinction between a control and an experimental group, but we just start with the assumption that there are case studies, so I took case studies, and we have effect size observations, DI, and we have sampling variances in each study. And the fixed effects meta-analysis model then assumes that the effect size estimate in the or let's say the I should say the observed effect size in the ith study is distributed according to a normal distribution with expectation given by the true but unknown effect size, and a variance that is specific to that study and is known. And for, like I already said, for the standardized effect size estimates that we've seen previously, where our DI was essentially the difference between averages divided by the standard deviation, which was then non-centrally t-distributed, this is a large sample approximation. So if you assume that within the study you have many participants, or let's say over 50, then assuming this is of course reasonable, with the additional assumption that you actually assume that the variance is known exactly. And what happens as far as my reading of this meta-analysis literature goes is that of course there are estimates of the within study variance in papers that you're looking at, so there are standard deviations or variances that have been computed, and they are then taken as the true values if you do a fixed effect meta-analysis. So it's not taken into account that these are actually estimates. And the aim then, of course, here is to estimate this true but unknown effect size on the basis of the observed effect size is DI, so in each study you have a given effect size, and the known variances of the different studies. For me, this assuming that the within study variance is known, this was most striking, because that's usually not happening, that you take that you have some data, average it, for example, get a sample mean, and then also compute a standard deviation, and you take this for granted that this is the true standard deviation. Although there's something slightly in this direction also if you do brain imaging, where you estimate the variance over many voxels and then you assume it's not. Anyway, that's a little bit similar. Good, so that's the model, yeah? Fairly simple. It's assumed that's one true effect size, and the observed effect size in the different studies are normally distributed and with known variances. Of course, it's a different model from what we've seen on the standardized effect size. The estimation is hence also a little bit different, and this is, I think, quite a nice result. So, if you now want to estimate this parameter delta here, this you don't have to estimate, or these you don't have to estimate because you know all of them, and then you get to this maximum likelihood estimator, namely the maximum likelihood estimator for this delta value is the weighted sum of all the individually observed effect sizes, and the weights are given by 1 over the within study variance. This means essentially that if you have a study that has a high within study variance, that the effect size contribution of this study to your overall estimate is fairly low. Because you have high variance, then this weight factor gets very small, and this observed effect size does not contribute much to the overall maximum likelihood estimate of the true but unknown effect size. However, the other way around, if you have a small within a study variance, then the effect size from this study contributes a lot. This is nice in the sense that you would like to, of course, have those studies that come out with kind of reliable estimates, so very low or very high precision estimates to contribute more in your meta-analysis to your final estimate than those which have quite some variability. So that's nice. So what I'm then always interested in is, okay, if this is the case, if this is supposed to be the maximum likelihood estimator, how can I see that this is actually the maximum likelihood estimator? And hence I then try to prove these theorems or these results in the literature, and this is then shown here. So who, please raise your hand if you are familiar with maximum likelihood estimation and actually doing that, not only having heard the term but actually computing. If you're familiar with what do you want to be familiar with, did you go over how to derive the maximum likelihood estimator and the GLM? Who went over the derivation of the maximum likelihood estimator and the GLM? Katrin? Felice? Okay. You will then know what is going on here. For the other ones, it's always basically following the same approach. So you first write down the likelihood function, which means that you write down the probability of the observations as a function of the parameter you're trying to estimate. So in this case, the parameter that you're always of interest is the true but unknown effect size. And we said that the observations here, or DI, are normally distributed. So we just have for the likelihood function, we have just the product of the different normal distribution corresponding to the individual studies. So we just have this as a product, because we assume that the different studies are independent, and independence corresponds to factorization. Then the next thing that one looks at is usually the log likelihood, because that simplifies things. For those who are familiar with maximum likelihood estimation in the normal distribution, One difference here is that this sigma square I depends on I, which is, if you think about doing maximum likelihood estimation just for Gaussian, there you usually assume spherical covariance matrices where the variances are all the same. Here they depend on I, like the outcome measure. This, of course, carries over if you take the log, and then maximum likelihood, at least in its analytical version, where you don't use some numerical approach to find the maximum of this log likelihood function, then always corresponds to computing the derivative with respect to the parameter of interest and setting to zero. So you, like in school, you're trying to try to find maxima or minima, so extremal points. And by computing derivative setting to zero, because you know that at the maximum or minimum that the function doesn't change, so the first derivative vanishes as a necessary condition. And if you do this here, you get to essentially this likelihood equation, and there you still have this dependency on the individual study variance. So if you set this to zero and then solve for the maximum likelihood, you maintain essentially this dependence on the within study variance, and end up with this weighted sum where the weights correspond to the inverse of the variances. So yeah, I was happy when I saw this, because then it this idea that in a meta-analysis you weight by the relative precision of the different studies falls out of the maximum likelihood estimation. And in a way, it was what we usually don't deal with are these observation-dependent variance parameters, which you have here. So that's the difference to maybe the very basic textbook Gaussian maximum likelihood, and it just delivers this result. Yeah, so that's the maximum likelihood estimator in a fixed effects model, fixed effect model. Questions about this point? No. Then there exists an alternative, which is the random effects meta-analysis model. And of course, it's not immediately clear whether one wants to do a random or fixed effects meta-analysis. The random effects meta-analysis model is, of course, a little bit more complex, although on first sight, maybe not even that much, but if it comes to estimation, it gets a lot more complex. So in the random effects model, we again assume that we have case studies, and we have again observed effect sizes, and within study sampling variances, which are again assumed to be known. But now we assume that the individual effect size observation is normally distributed not around the true but unknown effect size parameter, but around a study-specific, if you want, true but unknown effect size parameter, delta I. And this delta I is itself assumed to be distributed according to a normal distribution centered on the actual true but unknown effect size, and with variance tau square, which is the between study variance of these different true but unknown effect size in the individual studies. Yeah, so from an ancestral sampling perspective, you could think, okay, there's the true but unknown effect size. Now I don't know, I want to generate data from 10 studies, so I sample 10 times from this distribution, then I get the delta 1 to delta 10. For delta 1 to delta 10, I then sample the value of my ith study by putting in delta I and my known variance sigma square I. So there are now two variance components. One is the within study variance, and one is the between study variance. Yeah. So if one has a model like this, one always needs to think a little bit carefully what this now means and how one should actually read this. One could be a little more, could be a little bit even clearer with the notation by explicitly writing here that this is conditional on delta I, although this is fairly obvious. Because if you look at this in terms of the distributions that are behind that, you have a joint distribution of the observed effect sizes, so the DI in each study, and the study-specific true effect sizes, delta I, which also have a distribution but remain unobserved. And the DI are distributed conditional on the delta I. This is the how I would usually write this in probabilistic form. Then another way to conceive that is that if you think more in terms of structural models or like structural equation models, that the DI is given by the sum of the true but unknown effect size plus a random contribution that is given by the difference between this delta I and this true delta, which has the variance tau square, plus a random contribution that is given by the difference between the DI and the delta I. So yeah, you have these two random contributions, and then of course the problem that sets in terms of estimation is that you have a single number of which you know there's some deterministic effect, but there are two random effects. And even if you assume a specific true effect, you're not quite sure what to do with the difference from the true effect because it can be due to two sources of variance. So you have a typical variance component estimation problem. One thing that one also needs to be aware of in terms of the marginal variance, because this sigma square I, this is the conditional variance of DI, because DI of course varies both due to variation given a delta I, and also averaged overall delta I. So if you look at the marginal distribution, then basically from the Gaussian theory, it's very straightforward to compute the variance of the marginal distribution, which then has contribution both from the between and the within variance. Yeah. So these are different forms to look at this model. Yeah, I think I find this probabilistic form the most helpful. This is really readily implied there. And yeah, you find all forms. The question is then, of course, how to estimate the parameters here. Because here, what you need to estimate is, or you want to estimate, is the true but unknown parameter. And you have this between study variance parameter. And again, you assume that these variances are known, but this between study parameter, that's not assumed to be known. And this has been addressed in the meta-analysis literature in different ways. So there are different estimators for tau square, which are based on different forms of reasoning. And actually, the guy that we wanted to, or we actually invited for today, Fichtbauer, I don't remember his first name right now. Let me look that up. Herbert or something? Wolfgang Fichtbauer. He wrote an article in 2005 on the different estimators for tau square that have been around in the meta-analysis literature and that also have different kinds of performances. So they are not all very good estimators, let's say. And they all have been motivated, or they have been motivated from different principles. So One estimator that there exists is this so-called Hunter-Schmidt estimator. So these are always the inventors of this. One estimator that is fairly prominent and that I also try to work with in simulations a little bit is this der Simonian-Laird estimator, which is due to a paper by der Simonian and Laird from the 80s, so 1986 or something, in the medical literature. And what these estimators kind of have in common, they look at residual sum of squares. So they, for example, take this fixed effect estimator and compute the difference between the effect sizes and then square and sum over it and correct, or basically also use weighting with these inverse variances. They do so in different ways. Der Simonian-Laird apparently is motivated from the methods of moments, which is a method like maximum likelihood estimation. So my initial plan was to actually show you how this results from method of moments, but then if I went in, and then I went into it and I found also different papers, and it gets messy quite easily. So I decided not to actually try to figure out how these people came up with these estimators and just regard these estimators as there, because it's not quite clear also in their papers how they actually came up with these estimators. And in a way it's fine, so as long as your estimator has certain properties, so for example if it's unbiased, has very low variance, maybe it's consistent and so on, it doesn't really matter how your estimator came about. But this Fichtbauer paper also shows that they have different kind of performances. And when I tried to implement this, somehow I was not really lucky, so it didn't really work for me. Maybe I implemented something wrong, I don't know. There are, in any case, many estimators for this tau square between study variants, and they are reviewed in these two papers from 2015 and also 2016. The idea is then, if you have this tau square, if you have an estimated value for tau square, then you can plug that in into these weighting functions or weighting parameters and get optimized weights. And you might already notice that you then here use the fixed effects estimator here also. Now you get a random effects estimator by using this tau square, and then of course you might want to again re-estimate tau square based on your updated estimate of the true but unknown effect size. So you get into these iterative approaches. At that point, so if you look into, for example, into this R meta-analysis with R book, you find that you can, for random effects models, you can use all sorts of estimators. And then, it's also readily appreciated that they don't all give the same results. I think, Katrin, that's again a question for you. So do you have experience with random effects analysis estimators and how people deal with that? So my idea after looking into this was, okay, that's all nice. I think I go to looking into standard general linear mixed effects models. But is there something that you can tell us in addition?
No, not really. I mean, I don't really get what you are asking. So I don't. So what do you mean by how do people deal with this?
Now you have the thing is you have different estimators. So you have the same model, but you have different estimators that you can use to estimate a parameter of this model. And for example, if you look into what R offers you, you can choose this estimator or this estimator or this estimator. So I would then, what I would think what people do is either that certain groups always use this estimator and other groups always use this estimator, or people like to use all estimators and then look how they converge or anything in this regard.
I think usually people have some paper in mind that says that this and that estimator is the best one, so they just use the estimator that they think, or that they think that from literature search was the best one.
Yeah, well, then that also makes sense. So this Fichtbauer, although there are also a little bit of diverging recommendations. So I think the Fichtbauer paper from 2005, that definitely favors the maximum likelihood and restricted maximum likelihood estimators, as far as I remember. So that's, of course, so definitely that's also one approach to say we use this estimator because this paper said it's best.
Yep.
Okay, so yeah, for me, these were a little bit too many estimators. And also because the Fichtbauer also discussed the maximum likelihood and the restricted maximum likelihood estimators, which I'm familiar with from my neuroimaging work. So I then decided to look a little bit in how one can rewrite these models in terms of standard general linear models. And this is kind of the rest of this section. So who has seen this in this or a different format, this formula for the general linear mixed effects model, where you have a design matrix with fixed effects and better parameter with fixed effects and random effects as well? Okay, so that's actually a slight majority here, which is good. So thank you. So essentially, you can translate the random effects model of a meta-analysis into this standard form. And from my perspective, this is the most reasonable thing to do, because it's a little bit with these random and fixed effects models in meta-analysis, I felt a little bit reminded. This whole thing reminds me, of course, a lot of what's happening in brain imaging. First of all, you have these few people that do methods, and then everybody is following these few people that do the methods. And then a lot of things are just done because they started to be done at one point. Where was I going with this? The main, there is some idiosyncrasy in terms of that this kind of understanding the analysis in terms of just standard general linear mixed effects models, also in brain imaging, to appreciate this took some time, so that like in the 80s or 90s, maybe in meta-analysis, like in neuroimaging, people were focused on, for example, the fixed effects model and the random effects model with the, I don't know, Simonian-Laird estimator, like I've just shown you, but with a little bit of distance and trying to generalize this, you actually realize it's just a specific general linear mixed effects model. So it helps to look at things from this perspective, because it's more transferable, and it's also in a way simpler. So the GLM, as you then mostly know, looks like this. So what's here behind this is that y is a vector of k times one vector of random variables. In our case, this will be, of course, the observed effect sizes. Then you have a fixed effects design matrix, which you know. You have a fixed effects, which themselves do not have a distribution. And then you have another design matrix for the random effects, and the random effects themselves, they have a distribution, which is then assumed to be normal, centered on zero, and have a specific covariance matrix, which is of course positive definite. And then you have this other source of noise. So here, this is coming from the random effects. And then you have this epsilon random error term, which is essentially modeling the variation of each of these entries in Y, which is also normally distributed centered on zero with its own covariance matrix. And then readily from the joint distribution theorem for Gaussian distributions, you get to the fact that y marginally is distributed according to a normal distribution with expectation given by the fixed effects times the design matrix and the covariance matrix that results from transforming the covariance matrix of the random effects by means of the an R missing by in terms of the random effects design matrix and adding to it the within in this case within study effects. So this is essentially a generalization of our tau square plus sigma I as we've previously seen. And so that's just a review of general linear mixed effects models. There is, of course, a routine estimation theory for them based on maximum likelihood and restricted maximum likelihood approaches. Restricted maximum likelihood. Who has heard about restricted maximum likelihood? Eva? Else. So restricted maximum likelihood is a doch somebody else zwei. I don't see this again. Katrin, I guess. Restricted maximum likelihood is an approach to get unbiased variance estimates. So you might know that the maximum likelihood estimate for variance parameters is biased, and the restricted maximum likelihood estimate for variance parameters is not. And hence, usually most software packages, if you want, for estimating GLMs use restricted maximum likelihood. This book by Searle on covariance components, that's in my opinion one of the best books discussing mixed effects models and really going into detail about this in these estimation procedures. So what I'm trying to say is, if you look at meta-analysis models from the GLM perspective or the GLMM perspective, there is standard literature. It's not, you're not, you don't have to deal with the idiosyncrasies of meta-analysis too much. Yeah, one can parameterize variance components. It's a little bit just a reminder of standard GLM theory. You have the maximum likelihood objective function, you have the Hermel objective function. That's really not that important right now. The important thing is that in any case, you will get mutual parameter dependencies. So your estimate of the variance depends on your estimate of the fixed effects. And then you need to you always need to iterate between estimating variance and estimating the fixed effects. So what I then still took from the Fichtbauer paper, which is marginally interesting, is how the estimators, the maximum likelihood estimators and the restricted maximum likelihood estimators for the fixed and random effects meta-analysis model look. So the first thing that I included here is the general linear mixed model formulation of the random effects meta-analysis model, where the y that I've shown on a previous slide now become our observed effect sizes, our fixed effects fixed effects design matrix is just a vector of k1s, and the fixed effect is and the fixed effect is our delta, because the way I did it here is that I used, anyone can also do that differently and better, I used this formulation here. So I wanted to generate these contributions and these contributions, so the Xi and the epsilon I, using the GLM setting, and then I get to this formulation here. And based on this formulation, what I then tried is to basically using the standard likelihood formulations for the GLM, and then under these constraint to reproduce the maximum likelihood estimates for the effect size estimate and the variance estimate. If this more kind of an exercise, I think it's not really that interesting. One other reason why I say it's not really that interesting, because in the end I didn't quite succeed. So it worked quite well for the maximum likelihood estimators. So if you want to figure out how the maximum likelihood estimates for the random effects model play out, you can have a look at this. And if the problem was that, at one point I gave up a little bit. So in terms of the maximum likelihood estimate for tau and the Ramel, so it's the thing is, what I'm trying to do there is to go a little bit into detail into this paper. So this is the paper by the colleague from Maastricht, who couldn't be with us, and he lists all these estimators, but then he doesn't show where they're coming from, and to understand a little bit where they're coming from, we went into some depth, but then not fully. But this is kind of the things that I'm always interested in terms of model estimation. Good. So this would be my summary of this part. So the bottom line here is, and maybe that's not really a surprise for you, also wasn't for me, but it's nevertheless the bottom line. If you think about doing using some multi-level modeling, GLMM modeling of your effect size estimates, then you are basically, there's nothing special about meta-analysis, right? So there's a little bit special things in terms of which variances are known, which are not known, but in essence, you are in the standard GLM or mixed GLM setting, yeah? And then the questions of, for example, what to include as moderators and how to set up the model and so on. These are the standard questions that you always deal when you analyze data sets using a mixed model. So that's essentially the bottom line here. So that from my perspective, there's not much special stuff in meta-analysis with respect to this multi-level modeling slash GLMM modeling slash general linear model modeling. Yeah. So for me, after looking into this and going a little bit into how the fixed effects model looks in detail, how the maximum likelihood estimator of the fixed effects look, and a little bit that with the random effects model, there's a lot of things going on in the literature, but why not just use maximum likelihood or restricted maximum likelihood? Yeah, can be done. And I was kind of happy, and So now, again, I ask you, do you have questions, remarks, comments, what does it mean practically, or things like that? Remarks, questions, anything? No questions. Hello. Can you raise your hand if you're still there? Okay, no questions. In essence, this was also just telling you that the statistics for meta-analysis, if you use GLMs, is not different than other statistics. Good. So, if it's then coming to practical aspects in terms of your meta-analysis for evaluative conditioning and what to include in models and how to estimate them and so on. We can, of course, then talk more if this is actually happening. There's a question. Katrin.
Oh, I just forgot to take my hand down, actually. Sorry.
No worries. Good, yeah, so if it comes to, then, like I said, if it comes to the practical aspect of what to include in models and so on, we can discuss more. I think I feel confident to kind of, in terms of choosing. So this was one of the reasons why I initially didn't want to talk about meta-analysis, because one thing that I can, of course, do is, and can fairly quickly be done, is to understand the theory. The other thing is kind of the social norms in a research field, which you don't necessarily get that easily from just reading the literature. I mean, there are some indicators, for example, if people always refer to two papers and say they did it like this, so we do it like this, then you might, if you're doing a meta-analysis, you might also do it like that and just say, yeah, they did it like this, so we do it like this. But there are other social norms that, as an outsider to a given field, you not necessarily can get from the literature. Okay, good. Then I would suggest, because this was fairly quick and maybe also maybe not that horribly interesting, we go on to the last bit and continue straight away if there are no objections. Anyone objecting? No. The last thing is a little bit more, it's a little bit different, so I don't go over the estimation in any detail, because I didn't, essentially you can estimate the model that we're discussing in the last bit with maximum likelihood estimation, but I was interested in what kind of models actually exist there, and how they look, and what can be done. So the last thing that was on my list from this Hoffman paper was this point that they wanted to assess whether the present meta-analytic example might have been affected by publication bias. And this is also from me thinking about meta-analysis, as I said in the beginning, this is something that was or has always been on my mind, because I always think that there are way too many statistically significant findings in the literature. You hardly ever find null results published. Of course, in open research and open science, we also advocate publishing well-conducted null studies, and that it's important. But there's still very few. So what about publication selection effects or publication bias, or some people call it a file drawer problem, although I wouldn't call it that. How can one account for that in meta-analysis? So and this is more, so this last part is really mainly my personal interest. I don't know if you do your meta-analysis whether you actually want to follow this approach. I think there are these non-parametric things like funnel plots that one can do to look into that. I didn't go into details there. I was really interested in this model that Hedges proposed over a couple of years that tries to explicitly model publication biases in effect size estimation. And this is the last bit. So there, I think meta-analysis. So from my perspective, this is really meta-analysis or meta-science, because you now try to account for not kind of scientific things, but for kind of this academic effects that you get, and that's for some reason statistically significant effects get published easier than non-statistically significant effects, which is weird, but everybody is well aware of. So that then already explains a little bit of my motivation here. So, and the motivation also for this model by Hedges. So there is a strong domination of statistically significant results in the literature, essentially saying that there are very few null results being published. And in some way, this of course results in a publication bias of the effect size estimates. It's also, if one looks a little bit closely, does not necessarily mean that big. So if you have the same effect size, but you now have a study with very many participants compared to very few participants, then of course there's a favor for the study with the very many participants where you have the smaller p-value. So in a way, you have you favor p-values over effect sizes. Maybe this was not quite correct, but yeah. In any case, there is a bias towards statistical significance in the literature. And then the question behind this model that Hedges has proposed and that I'm now telling you about is how one can estimate this. So how to figure out how strong it is, and how one can also essentially subtract this out of the meta-analysis. So of course, if you have a good idea of how much your effect size estimates are affected by publication bias, then of course you can account for that and correct your effect size estimates accordingly. And the way this is addressed here in this model by Hedges from 1992 is that you basically, in your generative model for the effect sizes, you put in an effect of publication selection based on the p-value, and then you estimate the parameters. And you take, when estimating your true but unknown effect size, you take this publication selection effort into account. So like I said, I will now not talk much about the estimation of this, and there will be more figures. It's a little bit lighter this session. We will focus on the model formulation, because essentially this is how far I got. If you are interested in, let's see, does that do anything? If you are interested in this whole p-value business, there is a very nice special issue in the American Statistician from end of last year, which has many articles on p-values and their use and abuse in statistics. So that's fairly interesting if you want to if you're interested in statistics and you kind of feel a little bit weird about this p-value focus of some parts of the academic world. So now I need to figure out how to get back. So do you see the screen again, my PowerPoint screen? Please raise your hand. Yo, very good. Thank you. Good. So there's much more to learn about p-values if you want. Here we basically take for granted that there is this p-value effect in publication. Now the idea is to build this into a meta-analysis model. Katrin, are you familiar with this Hedges model from 1992, or do we finally also have something new for you?
No, that's actually already new for me.
Very good. Then you also learned something. Good. I think it's new. I think hardly anyone uses it. So that's maybe the bad news. But I think I just found it interesting. So I mainly put it in because I'm interested in this. I think most people just use this funnel plot thing. This is now more experimental. So what is this publication selection effects model? It's essentially the random effects model that we've seen, where we assume that there's a true but unknown effect size. We have a between study effect size variance. We have case studies, and we have observed values di of effect sizes and known variances sigma square I within the studies. And this publication selection effects model, which I call P, which was proposed by Hedges in 1992, now assumes that DI, so the observed effect size in the I study, is normally distributed, which is here expressed in the in terms of a standard normal distribution. So you have a Z transformation, but in a way you can ignore it. So it's just Z transformed. So that the DI is actually normally distributed with expectation delta and variance at I, which is sigma square I plus tau square, which we'll see in a second. But it's the normal distribution assumption here. So this is as we did before. But then there's this weighting function, and the whole magic of this model is in this weighting function. So this W is a p-value-based study publication probability function. So what this will do and what this does is that instead of saying the probability to observe this and this effect size is just a function of the true but unknown effect size and the variances, it also says that the probability to observe a given effect size is a function of the p-value that this study generates. And this is embedded in this weighting function, which we will look at in some detail. This value function, and this is why there's this little a and this little omega, has parameters. What these parameters mean, we will also look at in some detail. Phi, as I said, is the standard normal distribution. So here after that transform, this just means that we still have the normal distribution assumption. And this eta I square is tau square plus sigma square I. So this is just that we're talking about the marginal distribution of this random effects model. So essentially, we are dealing with the random effects model as we've seen it just a couple of minutes ago. But now we're putting in a weighting factor that essentially diminishes the probability to observe a given effect size if this effect size is associated with a low p value. How exactly will we see in a second. So the first thing that I wanted to clarify is that that this is actually the random effects model. So that's maybe not that interesting. So you can look at that, and it's essentially just what I said. So you have this marginal variance, which is here in the eta I, and then from the set transformation you get to this phi I. So that's just a side remark. The essence of this model is actually this weighting function. So this is this p-value based study publication probability weighting function, I think. So again, we assume we have our observed effect size in study I, and we have the true, we have, as I said, we have this random effect model. So we have a study-specific true but unknown value, delta I. We have the within study variance, and we assume, again, our, like previously, our normal distribution around delta I and sigma square I. Now the model, the logic of the model works as follows. So we assume that in the I-th study, the null hypothesis delta I is equal to zero, or is in the subset of parameter space corresponding to zero, is tested using the Z statistic. We don't need a T statistic here because we assume that the variance and the standard deviation are known. So we are just dealing with Z statistics. And we are dealing with a two-tailed p-value. So our z-statistic is given by the absolute value of our effect size divided by the standard deviation, which then has an associated p-value, as I will show you on the next slide graphically, of two times the cumulative density function of the standard normal at location minus that I. I will show you pictures that I think makes it quite clear. The main point here is that we assume that in each study there's the effect size, but there's also a p-value, which of course depends on the effect size and the variance. Yeah, and the effect size and variance we have, so we can always also compute the p-value. And then the idea is that we actually have a step function over p-values. And allocate a certain weight for publication in bins of p-values. So for example, between 0 and 0.05 as a p-value, we assume that the publication probability is high. For a p-value between 0.05 and 0.2, we assume that the publication probability is lower, and so on. So for example, a p-value above 0.5, we may assume that the publication probability is almost zero or 0.1 or something like this. Now to get to this p-value weighting function, we also actually need a partition of the space or the interval 0 to 1, because we need to say where our p-value bins are, and these we specify in terms of these parameters a0, a1, a2. So we basically, as I will show you in the next graphically on a slide, we partition this interval between 0 and 1 into bits, and on each of these little bits we then assign a certain weight. And the assumption of this model by Hedges is that we pre-specify the bins of p-values and we estimate the weight we assign to each p-value. So the a's will be known, but the omegas are free parameters of the model. So the idea is then that a0 is always 0, a1 is the smallest p-value. So for example, if we have our first bin between 0 and 0.001 as the p-value, then we would give this a publication probability of 1. If then we go to the next bin, for example, from 0.001 to 0.05, there we give a value smaller than 1, so for example 0.9, or maybe even larger, and so on. And these weight parameters, this is what we want to estimate from our observed effect sizes. So here's a visualization of that. So first, in terms of the p-values that we're talking about, so the basic idea is that if we observe a z value, for example here of 1.7, then the associated p-value of that is then of course given by the area under the curve here and under the curve here. So that's this two-tailed logic, and we can get this this area under the curve of course from the cumulative density function, which gives us the probability that the random variable is smaller than a given value. And because we are interested in both tails, we need twice this here. So twice phi minus 1.7 is this plus this, and this is only here minus 1.7, so we need twice this, 0.9. So that's the logic. And then we can, of course, look at the p-value as a function of the effect size and the variance, which I did here. So here you have the effect size varying between 0 and 2 and 0 and minus 2. And in color, you see the associated p-value, which of course depends on the within study variance. So if you have very low variance, then your p-values are, of course, easily at also small effect sizes, very small. So you have highly significant results if you have very little variance. If you have higher variance, of course, then you get to lower p-values, and the whole thing is symmetric. About 0, because we both consider negative negative and positive effect sizes. But this is how the p-values depend on the observed effect sizes and the observed and known standard deviations. So these p-values then enter this weighting function, and this weighting function returns the probability of a study effect size di to be reported as a function of pi, so the p-value. This is already what I explained. This is also what I explained. This I also mentioned. So this shows here what I tried to say in terms of the p-value and this partition. So these red dots here, or these orange dots, are these A values that create the bins of P values. And there are actually two red dots here very close to each other. So one at 0 and one at 0.001. And between those, the probability for publication is 1. And then if then the next bin is from 0.001 to 0.05. And here I assume that the publication probability then is 0.9, and on it goes. So for example, the last bin here is between 0.5 and 1, where I still put in a publication probability of 0.1. And again, these parameters A, you would prefix them. These parameters you would estimate from the data, so from your observed effect sizes. So these are then further visualizations of this. So what this graph here shows is in terms of the effect size at a fixed standard deviation, it shows the p-value. So the p-value, of course, as the effect size gets larger, negative or positive, the p-value drops. Of course, it drops faster if you have a very small variance. It drops less fast if you have very high variance, but here the variance is fixed. And then depending on how high the p-value is, for each effect size, you get an allocated publication probability. And this, in a way, shows then the entire complexity of this model, if you want, because it shows the weight function as a function of both the effect size and the variance. Essentially, these weight functions, they become they become broader as you increase. This gap in the this downweighting becomes broader as you lower the variance, because you get to less significant p values. So this is a last look, if you want, at this, which I find quite instructive. So this is the, here again, you have the, on this side, you have the normal distribution of your effect sizes, depending on the true but unknown effect size and the within study variance. And you see that if the true, or the, if the, for this study, the effect size, I think it should be delta I, that would be better. If this expected value is 0, then you send it at 0, you send it at 1, you send it at 2. But this doesn't account for the fact that if you actually have a non-significant result, then you might actually not see this in the literature. And this is where this weighting function comes in, and then you can basically just think about multiplying this probability density with this weighting function, and then you get these very funky probability density function for observing effect sizes in the literature. So for example, in this case, when the true but unknown effect size is 0, you get your weighting And yeah, it's zero, then it actually matches quite where the weighting function downweighs most. You get this kind of symmetric shape. Now, if you have strong effect size, basically the observation of effect size moves a little bit into this direction where you have a higher publication probability, and then it's only partly affected. Or at one point, if you actually have a very high true effect size and a relatively low variance, then you actually observe actually in the literature the effect size as they actually are. Of course, and this is what's not shown on this graph, this depends on the variance. So again, if you make the, in this case, the variance larger, then of course this effect, these effects also carry over, and you get these very funky weighted probability density functions. So so this is basically a generative model of how observed effect sizes in the literature come about, not only because of nature, if you want, of how effect sizes then yield observed effect sizes according to normal distribution, but also taking into account that studies with low p-values you hardly ever observe, and hence you get these kind of freakish probability density functions. So there is more to say about this, but I will actually not do that now. So one thing that is important in terms of the model formulation of this model is that, yeah, just a second, is that this was just explained in terms of a proportionality statement. So you need to actually, to make this analytically valid, you need to normalize this. So this is why in this Hedges paper, and there's quite some stuff on the normalization constant, which I worked a little bit on. One thing that I tried to also do on it, I didn't, so I thought I might be able, but then there was too much Corona, and no, in the end, I didn't figure out was to, or I didn't set down to do, was actually to now estimate this model. So I, as you saw, I implemented most parts of it, but I did not really implement a sampling from it, and hence I also did not really implement a model estimation. So I can't really tell you how much data you need to actually reliably estimate these weight parameters. So from the paper by Hedges, it's more in the order of 1,000 studies. So he looks at a very big data set there, and to get estimates for these weighting parameters. I don't think it works very well if you have like 20 studies from which you now try to estimate the publication weighting parameters. So let me just summarize this, and then we do questions. So the basic idea here is, and this is what for me this really feels like meta-analysis, is that the observation of effect size in the literature is affected by the fact that we look into the literature, and that in academia highly significant results are advantage or have an advantage for being published. The other way to address this, of course, if you don't want to do these kind of things and take this into account, you can push for that also null effects being published more, and that your supervisor does not tell your colleague if it's not significant, then we cannot publish it, so that these things don't happen. But even if these things happen, one can account for the publication bias. And in the end, I mean, mainly I presented this and I liked it because it's a nice exercise in probabilistic modeling. It's not, I don't think it's heavily used, and because it's a little bit more complex than other things. Good, but this is then in terms of, we wanted to assess whether the present meta-analysis might have been affected by publication bias. Like I said, I think there are easier ways to address this than this Hedges model, but this Hedges model is just nice. Good, yeah, so there was a question, Alexander.
Yeah, I had the question to the graphs in the end, because for me it's not really clear how we can interpret them. For example, you showed that they differ on the variance, and but for me, their graphs are, or the right graphs are not really showing, or I cannot interpret them. Can you explain that?
These here?
Yeah, these graphs.
Yeah, so what this shows is, these essentially show the assumptions of the model. So the standard assumption of a random effects model under a true effect size of 1 for this study would be that the observed effect size in this study would be normal. So if you sample, if you view it from a formal sampling perspective, if you sample, so the true effect size is 1 and you sample, then most of the time you would get values around 1. Sometimes you get to the negative extreme, but most of the time you get this. So this would be if all studies were published regardless of their p-value, yeah, then you would have this distribution of observed effect sizes di. Now, what the model assumes is that if you have a very low p-value, if you have a very high p-value in the sense of very non-significant, then you will not observe this. Yeah. So the observation probability for example, a study that has an effect size here of 0 is virtually 0, even if the true effect size is 1, because the p-value of this study will be such that its weighting is really low. Yeah, so this basically results from this weighting function here. So if you have a p-value that's, if you have a p-value that is in the range above 0.5, so you have something that is really not statistically significant, then it's very unlikely to get published, meaning that your observed distribution of effect sizes, if the true effect size is 1 and you assume this normal distribution, is actually this distribution where you have a high probability for observing, for example, this, but you have a very low probability for observing these kind of values because they just generate not very high p-values. Does it make some sense?
Yeah, thank you.
I think the main point here, so I think the easiest, I think, to understand is this. The other graphs then just get a little bit more funky, and one has to think about how to interpret them. But the main thing is that this graph shows how from very likely to being observed to very unlikely to being observed, an effect size is affected by its associated p-value. And of course, the effect size is not the only thing that determines the p-value, but so is the variance. And this is why if you look at different variances, you get slightly different weighting functions and slightly different observed effect size observations, distributions. Yeah, Felice. The good thing is, Felice, hello?
Yeah.
The good thing is here one doesn't need to, so if we were...
Did you want to say something in addition?
No, I just wanted to say that I know your name, because if we were in Stuttgart in classroom, I usually don't remember the names. But here I know the names because they existed. Anyway, Felice.
That's nice. I'm a little bit puzzled by taking the p-value as an indicator for this, or as a parameter in this model, because isn't it the case if we take p-hacking into account that many people will reach a p-value of 0.05 or 0.49 or something, and then we have a different distribution of p-values and can't really... deal with that?
Yeah, so there is this thing about the distribution of p-values. I didn't really look into that for this. Here, actually, yeah. We don't, there is no distribution of p-values. So we don't say anything about how p-values are distributed. We just say how we just about p-values, we just say two things, or this model just says two things. One thing is depending on the effect size in a given study and depending on the variance of a given study, the p-value takes a certain number, which is clear. I mean, because that's how the that's just how the p-value follows from the definition of the test statistic that we're interested in. Yeah. So the p-value, if you have a given effect size and a given variance, then you have a certain p-value. It's not a one-to-one mapping, because you can have the same p-value can arise from different combinations of effect size and variance. But essentially, if you have the effect size and the variance, then you know the p-value. But the distribution here is only about the effect sizes. And if you want, the only distribution that then follows here is the distribution of p-values given an effect size. But here, so maybe that's a little bit what you refer to as distribution. But here it's then not talking about how the p-values are distributed, but that the observation of a given effect size is already, in terms of the p-value, modulated. Yeah. So we are actually not talking about the distribution of p-values, but we are saying if a study has a p-value of 0.5, then we not observe it, essentially. So that's the idea of this model. I'm not saying that it's the best model ever, but that's the idea of the model. So we are not, so in terms of p-hacking, that would mean essentially, so I think it's not actually, so p-hacking would, it would not solve the problem of p-hacking, if you want. Because with p-hacking, because for high p-values, I always say high p-values when I mean very low p-values. So for very low p-values, so strongly significant p-values, we still observe them. So if people do p-hacking, so p-hacking is essentially not accounted for here. That's what I would say. This assumes that everybody does proper work and no p-hacking, but then if you have a true null effect, this null effect will not see the light of the literature, so it will not be published. So this is what this is dealing with. And how this relates to this distribution of p-values, that is a deeper question.
If I can add to that, maybe I think doing an analysis of, I mean, if you have the p-values from studies, that you just take them and see if they, you know, if the distribution is so that it's crowded around 0.05, and then you maybe have an indicator that something's wrong there.
Yeah.
I now understand that it doesn't necessarily have something to do with that model. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. So that's, like I said, there are easier ways to check whether some publication bias may be affected. I think the general line is that p-values should be uniformly distributed over this interval of significance, which I think we'll need to show a little bit. But definitely, like you say, if you find a lot of them just at the border, that looks a little bit weird. Like I said, there are easier ways to do that, and like I said, I think hardly anyone does this, but that was mainly my interest to check out how one can actually model these kind of academia, not science, but academia effects explicitly. And still, I mean, even if you find something that maybe your p-values are not distributed as they should be, if they all were valid, the question remains how you then account for that and how you compute that out of your meta-analysis, right? And I assume there are also different ways to do that, simpler than this model. I just think this model is cool. Yeah. Continue. Felice.
Awesome. Yeah, my internet connection is not the best. Sorry. The second thing I wanted to ask, if you see, if you saw what Hoffman did, did you see that in the meta-analysis?
You mean the funnel plot?
Yeah, I think they just put effect sizes and sample sizes. They plotted. It's on page.
On page
403, yeah.
It's this funnel plot logic, right?
Yeah. So do you think it's legitimate to do it that way, or?
Yes. The thing with the yes, of course. Thing with the funnel plot is that the logic of it, the logic was not immediately clear to me. So there is also some theory behind these funnel plots. Is some form of non-parametric estimation. The thing is, I did not prepare that, but I think yes. So, like I said, I think the funnel plot, that's also, if you look into this meta-analysis with R, that's what the packages also offer you. So it's definitely something one can do. I just wanted to focus on this because I wanted to have a little bit of fun. That's what Felice shows. Any other questions regarding the last bit? No. Good. So then I'm actually done. Yeah, so what we went over was standardized effect size estimation. I think this was really where we could cover, because it's also fairly not the biggest topic, so where we actually covered, I think, the essential theory in depth. So that's at least for our independent group study models, fixed random and mixed effects models, standard statistics if you want, and this last bit a little bit because I was interested in it. And yeah, so then from my perspective, the question is then for you guys, what you want to do with your meta-analysis. Like I said, there's meta-analysis with R. So what I can offer is to help you with your meta-analysis. But of course, the question is whether you actually want to do this meta-analysis, whether there's a critical mass of people that actually wants to do that. And also, I guess the question is also how long this Levico is still, and so on. So it means in terms of years, so whether you now want to really get started on that or not, and so on. So there, I just don't know what the plan is. Anyway, so what from my perspective, I try to give you a little bit of a overview of some aspects of statistics and meta-analysis. I also emailed a little bit with this Fichtbauer guy, so Wolfgang Fichtbauer, so we can of course also ask him, and I think some of you also work in meta-analysis groups, so if there are more detailed questions, and then of course I'm also confident that I have quite some statistical background, so I can advise to a certain degree. So then the question is what you guys want to do. So anyway, the discussion is then open, and you discuss, or you just say that was all very nice, and now back to Corona news. So I'm done. Goodbye. No, not goodbye. You talk now.
Can I just quickly ask the other topic of meta-analysis? Is that still that's not an option anymore, right?
The other topic of meta-analysis?
For a meta-analysis?
There were initially two projects.
Yeah.
About that, because the second topic was targeted memory reactivation. And from my perspective, it didn't really work out. So we can also